Hello, hello, hello. Welcome to Twitch Stream Thursdays. My name is Mofi and I have
Nick, and I'm going to teach you about AI today.
All right, Nick. I like the energy in your voice, Nick. Usually, a lot of people have told us like your voice usually stays to the low, so I think you're changing that today.
Yeah, I'm just really excited because Today we're there. We're at the finish line of this basic neural network. We can be done with it after this episode.
Wait, are we? Seriously?
Yeah.
Oh, basic one.
Basic.
Okay. Yeah, then we're going to get to the actual,
even
non-basic ones. Okay.
Yeah, big boy stuff.
I mean, I'm excited. Hopefully, our audience is excited as well. And if you haven't gotten a chance already, and if you, the things Nick talked about today, we have been doing that for a few weeks now. So if you want to check them all out, they're all on YouTube. You can find them on youtube.com/MofiCode. That's our channel. And we finally got like our short channel handle before we had like big URL. So now... Yeah. Well, thank you to you guys for subscribing. Now you can get like a short channel name. So without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Nick. You're going to get to the page where Nick has his beautiful iPad typing, writing all of these things in.
With my horrible handwriting.
Horrible handwriting. I think, that's a given.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think this is part three of backpropagation. So if you remember last time, I think we did like a three-node neural network. We had an input, we had one hidden layer and one output.
Yes.
Right? And we're doing that like basic Fahrenheit to Celsius or vice versa. I forget which one. But we're going to do something a little bit more interesting today. We're going to change gears a little bit, make it more suited to classification.
Okay.
So eventually we want to be able to build a neural network where we can show it a picture and it'll tell us what the picture is. So we're going to start with a network today that kind of moves us in that direction. And instead of doing classification of pictures, we're going to be doing classification of numbers. And so we're going to give it an input, and our network is going to tell us something about this number. I'm going to use negative and positive. So if it's negative, it'll tell us it's negative. If it's positive, it'll tell us it's positive.
So, okay. And so the input node is going to some numbers. An output node is a string that says positive or negative? Or?
So it's actually going to be two nodes.
Okay.
One is going to be negative, and the other one's going to be positive. And whichever one has a higher number, we're going to lean towards that as our label.
Okay. Got it.
So we'll end up with something like 0.0001. For negative and 0.9999 for like positive.
Got it.
So I'm gonna draw like a quick sketch of like what this network will look like. We're gonna do a hidden layer with two nodes this time. Last time we just had a hidden layer with one node. So this will bump up the complexity from last time, as well as have two output nodes. So here's what that will look like. So we have our x, and then we have a hidden one, and a second hidden, and x will go into h1, and x will go into h2. And then we'll have a node that represents negative, and we'll have a node that represents positive.
Got it.
And H1 will connect to positive and negative, and H2 will also connect to positive and negative. So like this is like starting to look a little bit more like an actual.
Yeah, but like so far we have only one hidden layer. You said we're gonna have two.
No, one hidden layer with two hidden nodes.
Got it.
Or two nodes in that layer.
Okay.
And then we'll also still
need
have
the
our bias. I'm gonna just do a dotted line. It's more phantom. And then that will connect to positive and negative. So this is what our graph's going to look like. So if we put in negative 1 here, we'd expect this to be 1 and this to be 0.
Or like a really big number. Or do you want exactly 1 and 0?
It'll never be above.
Right. It's between 1 and, like, it's probability. So.
Right.
But like for example, this is probably pretty simple. So we'll probably reach like really close to 1 and really close to 0. But in reality,
it'll probably be something like 80, like or 0.8 or 0.2 or a little bit fuzzier. So if you remember previously,
like about Yeah, previous.
We're in our previous last episode.
Yeah.
We completely just threw away the idea of activation functions.
Right.
And we could do that because the function we were using was linear.
Mm-hmm.
So we didn't really need those non-linearities. We're going to bring those back into play here.
Okay. But is this non-linear though? But we're just bringing it back to show it? Or do we need it for this kind of like that?
I think we could get away without... Well, we could get away without having like a ReLU on this hidden layer.
Okay.
But we still need it. We need an activation function for this negative and positive node. And I'll get to that in a little bit. But yeah, I wanted to bring ReLU back just so we can kind of see how we deal with that whenever we're doing our derivatives for our graph.
Okay.
So I'm actually going to redraw this.
Okay.
This time I'm going to show it with the activation functions.
Got it.
Just so it's a little bit clearer what's going on. So we're going to, again, we're starting with our x input. And that's going to go into this hidden one. And actually, I'm going to draw an underscore for h1. And this is just to kind of, for me to remember that this is an intermediate value before passing it through the activation function. And then we also have h2, and that's also an intermediate. And x is going into both of those. And then h1 is going to go through this ReLU of h1. And that's going to be our actual h1.
Okay.
And then it's going to go through this, or the h2 is going to go through ReLU of our intermediate h2. And that's going to be our actual h2.
But like in reality, most likely this is just one step. We're just drawing it just
right.
To clarify
just,
a little more.
So whenever we're doing our derivative and stuff, we don't like forget about what's happening there. It'll make it a little bit easier, as we'll see. And then there's not going to be any weight associated with these. So that's
just passing one
constant.
To one.
Right.
Just multiplying that by one.
But of course, these will have a weight. So weight one, weight two. And then we're going to have our bias. And try not to. B1, B2.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have this these H's going into this N and P. And those are also going to be intermediates.
So you're going to also pass it through a ReLU, right?
So this, we're actually going to introduce a new type of activation function.
Okay.
It's called softmax. I'll get to that in a second. So we have this.
If I'm not wrong, we've probably seen the softmax before in an example. Where is it the one where you...
Are you thinking of sigmoid?
I probably am.
Those S's.
Yeah.
We might have talked about softmax. I don't really remember.
Okay, we'll see it again.
Softmax is what we normally use for classifications, and I'll show you why we do that in a second. But yeah, so then these connect into here like normal. And then we're going to just have our weight 3, weight 4, weight...
That's a good thing about...
Weight 5,
having
weight
a digital
6.
Writer, you can just erase.
Yeah. And then, again, we're going to have our bias of 1, and that's going to go... Make this really messy. This will be B3. And B4. Okay, and then so now this needs to go through softmax. And softmax is a little different than ReLU. With the ReLU, we only pass H1 into ReLU and H2. They're kind of like isolated.
Right.
With softmax, it takes into account all the other nodes. So it's going to be more like how everything connects to everything. So we're going to have this softmax. And it's going to have this N, but it's also going to take into P. But it's important to remember that it's not just taking in this P. If we had more layers,
mm-hmm.
more outputs, it would be taking in those as well.
So and the calculation of softmax seems a bit more involved then?
Yeah, and I'll show you what that function is in just a second.
Okay.
So then I'm going to draw this one too, softmax. And it's going to take in P and then the rest of the nodes.
Okay.
And then this will be our actual N and our actual P. And these are fully connected. Oh gosh, look at those beautiful wobbly lines.
I mean, if your goal was to draw squiggly, you would probably like you got like an 8 out of 10 there. But
thank you. So yeah, each one of those, they also the connections are just 1-to-1.
Okay.
And then so now let me
and just a suggestion, you want to probably like choose like a little bit darker color because I'm looking at the stream on the side here. It looks a little bit light. I don't know if you want to choose a darker color for this.
I'll move to black.
I mean, you can choose a darker green if you're.
I don't even know how to change.
You can just tap on it again. And just like choose a darker green.
Ooh, that's a pretty green.
And actually, while we're at it, I'm gonna quickly just change everything to that darker green. Okay, and then tap that, click on color, choose a darker green. There we go.
Wow, that's magic.
Well, technology.
Thank you, Mr. Move.
Yeah.
All right, so I'm going to write out what the softmax would be. And I'm going to talk in terms of this first softmax.
Okay.
So the softmax is... It's a ratio, I guess.
Oh.
and it's E to this to whatever the actual input node is. So in this case, it's this like N. And then it's over the sum of all of the nodes. So it'd be E to this N plus E to the P. And then if you had other nodes, it'd be plus...
Well, just by looking at the function, one thing it's good though that this is equal, so you can just calculate that once and you don't have to keep doing that over and over. That's a little bit nicer.
Yeah. So, and then for P, it would be the same just with P on the top.
Right.
So that's what the softmax is, and that gives us, that scales it. So with N and P here, those could be anything like 999 and 1.2. And softmax kind of crunches it down into a probability, so it's from 0 to 1. But then it's a probability with the exponents. So
right.
It the further away, or so like a larger number has much more power than a smaller number. So like so let's say you had like 7 and 5.
Okay.
If you were to take like a normal ratio of that, it would be like 7 over 7 plus 5.
Mm-hmm.
And let me just calculate that out right now.
7 over 7 plus 5?
Yeah.
7 over 12?
Yeah.
That's like 0.6 something.
Yeah, 0.6.
Yeah.
And then if we do that with this, the exponent.
So you're going to do e to the first 7.
E to the 7. So that's 1,096. So remember that.
1,096, okay.
And then e to the 12, 16,000.
No, 160.
That doesn't seem right. But, 12, okay. So.
160,000.
Forget what the first one was. So that'd be like 0.006. That doesn't seem right.
No. Because you're doing e to the 12, you should be e to the 5 and e to the 7.
Right. okay, so e to the 5.
148.
Okay. So it was like 1,000.
96.
All right, so.
1,096 divided by
1,096.
Divided by 1,096 plus 148.
Which is? 1,150. So that's like 0.8.
So basically, whatever is the bigger number, it just takes to the extreme of that
right.
big. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that was a mess right there. But
sure. No, I think that definitely explains the point a lot. But like, instead of, I mean, this is the same would be true even if we did something like n to the n for everything. It will be the same idea, right? Like,
right.
But like, probably e is the easier thing to calculate and easier, nicer. Most mathematicians, not probably us, but most people understand the graph of e easier, probably.
Right, and I think we have to remember that we're taking the derivatives of this, and I think natural logs and derivatives are a lot easier.
Yeah. A derivative of e is just e, so I think the derivative is a little bit easier to calculate.
Yeah.
Okay.
So next step is we need a loss function, right?
Right.
And previously our loss function was, do you remember?
It was, you had the change and you divided that by,
okay, so it was target minus the actual output from the network squared.
Right, yeah, that's what it did.
And then it was the sum of all of those. So if we had like two outputs, we just add that up and divide it by two. In this case, since we're doing classification, we're doing something a little bit different. And this is called, so the old one was we were using mean squared error.
Mm-hmm.
This one, what we're doing is categorical cross entropy.
Okay.
And what that is we expect all of the outputs to be zero except for one of them.
Okay.
So the function that we use for that ends up being, so here we have these two N and P outputs. So it ends up being the negative target N times the natural log of N. And then it's the sum of all of the nodes. So then it's plus the negative target P times the natural log of
How did he come to that calculation again?
So this is just what our error function, or our loss function,
okay.
our cross function is going to be. And so the way that works is, so since we expect, we put a number in,
mm-hmm.
we expect one of them to be zero, the other one to be
one. Yeah.
If we put zero into ln, what do we get?
Ln of zero is one.
And if we put 1 into ln, what do we get?
Isn't that 0? Right. I don't know. Hold on. Ln of 1. What is ln of 1? Check it. Totally forgot.
Where is ln?
Right here.
Oh, thank you.
0.
Yeah.
Okay. Ln of 0 is... Well, you can calculate ln of 0, can't we?
Like negative infinity.
Yeah. But then.
But yeah, that. So that's the basic.
Oh boy.
Okay. Never mind. So our target, is, so let's say we put in a negative. Our
mm-hmm.
target we expect it to be one, and our positive target we expect it to be zero.
Mm-hmm.
So it's zero times this natural log, and one times this natural log. And with our error function, we want it to be small. Like, so the more wrong, the higher that will be. So if our actual output is zero here,
mm-hmm.
That's one, right?
Right. Well yeah, ln of zero is error. Ln of zero is not right, right?
Right.
Okay.
It's math stuff. So this would be like negative infinity.
Uh huh.
But
that would be wrong because we want this because we want target to be one. We want this to be close to one as well, right?
Right. So if this is zero, it's going to be negative infinity, and it's multiplied by negative, so it's going to be infinity. So our error is infinity.
Okay.
If it's one, then it's going to be zero, so our error is going to end up being zero. and okay. vice versa with this.
Right,
this
but like series. This is target is already multiplied by zero. Doesn't matter what happens there, it will continue
right.
to be zero. Okay.
Yeah. So does that make sense? What's going
yeah.
on here? That's just what helps us.
Get either zero or one. Okay.
So this is our error function, and then now I'm going to go and write out this giant graph mathematically. So like the equation, what this would be. Let me have I copy this.
Just that one? Just this?
Yeah.
And just paste it there.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Okay.
Oops. Thank you. Okay. So I have notes here because I'm gonna mess it up. All right. So we already know what this n and p is.
Yes.
And it's this. So I'm not gonna rewrite that. We're just gonna remember that. I'm gonna do it in terms of this n and p. This like initial, this intermediate. So n is equal to. It's gonna be this h1, which is the ReLU of this initial h1. So I'm gonna start out by writing ReLU of, and then it's this h1. This initial h1, which is this. So that's x times w1 plus this bias 1. So x times w1 plus bias 1. And then that's multiplied by this 3, by this weight 3. Make sense?
Yeah.
And then, so this inner function right here, that's what h1 is,
mm-hmm.
and then this whole thing right here, that's our actual h1.
Right.
And then it's the same thing with h2, so it's going to be the ReLU of h2, which is x times w2
right.
plus the second bias.
B2.
B2.
Times W5.
W5, yeah. And then this is H2.
And the finally, you have to add the whole bias to it, right? That's H2.
And then
finally,
yeah,
you add the final bias, which is
B3.
Okay.
Perfect. And then we have P.
Yeah, P would be pretty similar to it.
Yeah, so it's going to be this ReLU again.
The H1 stays the same. You just multiply that by the other multiply W4, right?
Yep. So this is going to be X times
W1,
W1
plus B1 times W4. Plus ReLU of x times w2 plus b2 times w6.
So the same.
Yeah, just like the weight is different at the p level.
Right.
Otherwise, h1 and h2 are still the same.
And that's w6, right?
Yeah.
And then the bias is bias 4.
Yeah.
Cool. And then I'll just redraw that.
Oh, here, only thing, I think it should be, oh no, never mind.
And then these are the same H initials.
I think it's just H2, not underscore H2, right? Oh no, the middle part, okay,
yeah,
never
yeah,
mind.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so there we have our P's, and then those P's go through, or we have the N and the P.
Okay.
And that goes through our softmax.
Mm-hmm.
So now we need to put together these derivatives.
Cool.
Okay. So here's our oh yeah, I used to do this highlighter stuff. Here's our error function.
Yes.
And we need to find the derivative of this, right?
Okay.
And if we look right here, we have this little plus. So we can actually break this up into two derivatives, because it'll be kind of hard to, because there's two different variables going on here. So it's easier if we just split them up into two derivatives. So we're going to find the derivative of not just e to begin with. We're going to find the derivative of e with this n term and then e with this p term.
Okay.
So I'm going to write that down here. So we want to find dEn. Stick to these capitals. dEn. In terms of, let's start with this first W3 in terms of that weight. And we have to go through and find it in terms of all the weights, but we'll start with this W3 since it's the first of the last layers.
Okay.
Okay, so DEN.
DW3.
DW3.
Okay.
And then, since we split it, then we also need to find DEP, DW3. And then we're going to end up adding these together at the end. So if we look at DEN, we need to find the derivative of this.
Mm-hmm.
Do you happen to know what the derivative of ln is? So this, I guess, so target n, that's going to be
a constant. Yeah.
And then, so the only thing that's really changing is this n. So what's the derivative of ln of x?
1 over x?
Yes.
Right? Okay.
Yes. Look at you.
My calculus professor is going to be so proud.
Uh-huh.
I still remember it after like 5 years.
All right. So we're going to end up with something over something. So this x is n.
Right.
Actually, before I write that out, let's go through the whole chain of things. So we want to find dEn in terms of this n term, like I said, or like you said. There we go. So, and then we need to find dn in terms of, so what is n?
Well, dn depends on the underscore n, so.
Right. And n is our softmax, so we're going to find the softmax in term of this n. And we kind of have to be careful with this because there's also this p term. And here, it's just going to be a constant because nothing is, W3 doesn't go through p. But eventually, when we're down here, this W1, it ends up going through n, but it also goes through p. So we can't always treat p as a constant.
Right.
So that's something we just need to kind of keep
in mind. But like right now, we're just looking at dEn in terms of W3 at that part, we can consider that as a constant.
Right. Here, I should, instead of just saying it to you, I should. So W3 goes through this n term and into here. And nothing from p goes through there. So we can consider that a constant. But eventually, when we talk about W1, it goes through H1, through this ReLU. Then it gets split into P and W3, and then so both of those go through there. So we can't always treat the other one as constant. So we just gotta remember that. Okay. Anyway, back to business. So yeah, we can do it just in terms of this dn because the P is constant. Okay, and then we need to find dn. And what is dn equal of this, and we want to find W3, so this is n, and we want to find W3, so we can use this H1, right?
Mm-hmm.
So dn dH1, and then we need to again, dH1 dW3.
Okay.
Right? Just kidding. Yeah, just kidding. Okay. We don't actually need to do those last two. So we have D, N, and we want to eventually get down to here. So we can treat this as a constant. And then, so we can really just stop there. Stop there and just do DW3. And then that cancels out, so we have DN DW3. And then now let's go through and actually get those derivatives. So like you said earlier, the derivative of this would end up being
target n
negative
over
target
n
over
n.
N. Okay, so negative target n over n.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're going to multiply that by the derivative of n in terms of this intermediate n. So we need to find the derivative of this softmax, which proves to be slightly complicated.
Are we going to do the whole thing?
Oh, yeah. We're proving this bad boy. It's going to be a long day. So I'm going to come down to here.
Okay.
And then, so we have e to this intermediate n over e to the intermediate n plus e p. And I'm just going to like do this sum thing right here.
Because
just
it could be more than.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I always get tempted to just like subtract the n's out eventually, and then
right.
It's just like, no.
Don't do that, yeah.
Okay. So we want to find the derivative of this. We have...
And before you jump into this, because I know we talked about this equation a couple of weeks before, and when you're trying to like first solve it yourself, and so anyone watching this, I think you want to like disclaimer that this is not how you do AI in day-to-day life.
Right.
Right.
You don't need to do this unless you want to like invent your own activation
right.
functions.
So
but even then, like if you use Keras and you use like their operators, it like automatically calculates.
Right. So basically, what I'm trying to tell you guys that there is a light at the end of the tunnel. This is just to show that whatever we are doing in the computer or these libraries, they are doing this underneath.
Right.
So just to show you that this is not some sort of magic that solves your problem, but instead, very careful math by very smart people, and now we can just use it. But we're gonna just see how it works. So now you can, with
right.
that disclaimer, you can continue.
Yeah, and that second disclaimer, I had to like try to do this like 5 different times. I kept coming out with the wrong answer.
Yeah,
so.
And like then we got on a, we shared knowledge and like from our old calculus days to try to figure this out. So yeah, so like if you see this and be like, AI is not for you, this is not how AI is probably day-to-day life, right?
Right.
Okay, cool. With that disclaimer, you can continue down the rabbit hole.
All right. So... how do we deal with, we have a variable in the numerator and the denominator.
Yeah. Oh, man. I remembered the name of this.
It's the whole division thing.
Yeah.
It's like, I think it's some derivative of the top times the derivative of the bottom. Or no. The derivative. No. It's the top times the derivative of the bottom
yeah.
minus the bottom times the derivative of the top. Over
the bottom
squared.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. What is the name of that rule again? There's
it's like the quotient rule.
Quotient, yeah, there you go. Yes.
All right. So I'm going to draw a really long line because it's probably going to be a big long line. Okay, so the derivative, no, it's the top. So we just, the top times the derivative of the bottom,
mm-hmm.
which we know. Is I'm just going to keep this sum here just so we don't get tempted. So it's the derivative of e to the n is just e to the n,
yes.
right?
Mm-hmm.
E to the n plus
I mean, e to the p should be also e to the p, right?
Just kidding. It's backwards. I had it backwards. So it's derivative of the top, which is e to the n.
Right, right.
Times the bottom. So it's just times this.
Right. And the derivative we're taking in terms of n.
Right.
It's d over dn.
Right. I should write that
over. Yeah.
So
I think
d
over dn. And that's what the whole thing.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
You can probably move this over a little bit if you want to like write that proper.
Good idea. This magic lasso tool.
Yeah, you can just like.
That I just tap.
Here you go. You can just like click anywhere outside. Yeah. Okay.
Great.
I can type.
D, D, N. Do I put that in quotes?
And you can just put this in parentheses, then we know this is being applied to the whole thing. Okay, here we go.
There we go. Okay. So, yeah, again, derivative of the top, which is just e to the n,
mm-hmm.
times the bottom, which is just the bottom.
Right.
And then we're multiplying that by
the top times the derivative of the bottom.
Times the derivative of the bottom, which
where
is
in terms of, because t is a constant for our case, it's going to go
away,
so we're going to just e to the n.
And e to the n, and then that's a safe e to the n now because all of the constants
mm-hmm.
disappear.
Yes.
So it's just going to be e to this initial n, and then it's the bottom squared, so it's the sum of e to the n plus e to the p, and then like this is what I'm going to square.
Okay.
Cool. So now you can start to simplify this down because this is a mess. And we can boil it down to a really nice small thing. So I think what we want to do is extract out these ends. And I'm not pulling this all from just, you know, my good math skills. I have some notes over here because I don't want to make too many mistakes. okay, so we pull out this e to the n. Which is kind of logical because we just have like these e to the n's hanging out here. So I'm going to rewrite this e to the n times this the sum of these e to the n plus e to the p minus e to the n. Oh, great.
Yeah.
And then that's just going to be over r e to the n plus e to the p. I'm dropping these lowercase things. And then again, that's still the sum.
N squared.
Yep. I'm just going to leave that parentheses out because there's too many parentheses. Okay. And then what did we do?
Since we have multiplied, we can separate them out. Right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, so yeah, we're actually going to split this into two.
Okay.
So we're going to end up with e to the n over the sum of the e to the n plus e to the p. Sorry for my bad. And then multiplied by the sum e to the p. Okay. And then
the top, we can simplify a little bit, right? We have these two n's that we can probably cancel out.
No.
Oh, come on. Why not?
So, because we just kind of need to remember that's why I put this sum here.
Mm.
Because it's not just going to be like these n's, and then it's going to be, if we remove that one n, then it's just like a weird sum of everything but that n.
Mm.
So it's not going to cancel to how we're imagining.
Okay.
So I put this sum here so I mentally don't do the subtraction because that's what I always want to do. And that's where it went wrong. So what did I do here? Okay, so I split that out. Did I cross that e out?
You tried to at least.
Oh, wait, no, okay. So I just, so this is multiplied by this. So I have this sum of e to the n plus this e to the p minus e to the n. So we have these two beautiful things. We're at the finish line. There's only like one more thing we need to do, I think. So what do? We can break this up because we have this subtraction in the numerator. So this whole thing is going to be equal to, I'm going to try to write this one a little bit nicer, e to the n.
We're still writing the first part.
Right.
Okay.
Times the sum of this e to the n plus e to the p. I'm sorry for all of you at home that are watching this. This is not very fun. And then we're multiplying that. We're splitting this bottom thing, this top up. So we end up with two things times this. I'm just kidding. This was a...
the subtraction.
Yeah.
Well, we can just like put parts in parts. It's not... Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So then the sum of e to the n minus e to the p.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's the same over here. Sum of e to the n...
Plus
e to the p. And then the top is going to be this. So sum of e to the n plus e to the p. Hopefully you see something that can happen right here. And then the other side is just e to the n. All right. So what does this look like to you?
Well, if I could go back just a little bit, because the softmax right there.
Right.
But the softmax was the value of underscore n. No, so softmax was the value of just n.
Mm-hmm.
So if I have just something like that, I can just replace that with n now, right?
Right.
So this is just n, this is just 1, this is just n.
Yeah, so we end up with n times 1 minus
n.
Beautiful.
This is nicer than I expected.
So it went from this huge garbage mess to this nice little not garbage mess.
Right.
And you might notice here some sad news.
Sad?
Sad news. Also not that sad, but... So in this scenario, we had this n in the top and this n in this p in the bottom. So we had I don't even know what word I was thinking of. But that's the scenario of this. But what if we wanted to do d in terms of p, then that's going to, this is a constant, this is a constant, then this is a variable.
Mm-hmm.
So what we need to do is do this same derivative again.
Okay.
But this time thinking of it, well, actually, we're not there yet. We'll come back to that. But I'm going to just put a little disclaimer. So, well, we'll come back to that. So this ends up being n times 1 minus n. And we could cancel that or not. We'll just leave that there for now, just for clarity. And then we'll find dn dw3.
Okay.
Which is, this is n. So in terms of dn dw3 ends up being this h1, right?
Yeah.
So just times h1. Beautiful, right?
Because this part is, this whole thing is h1 times w3, that is constant, that goes away, w3
right.
becomes 1, you get h1.
Right,
okay.
Because there's no variables
right.
there. There's
right.
like w1, but we don't care about w1 and stuff like that. So this ends up being the first DE and DW3.
Okay.
And then we need to do the same thing for DEP. So that's just going to be the same old DEP. And then So that would be this, except P is going to be in the top now.
Okay.
But we still don't care about P because there's no variables back there. So that's going to be constant. And we have this W3. So it's going to be still in terms of DN. Does that make sense?
Right.
And then we have DN. DN. Just kidding. I was thinking one step ahead. So our first thing is this DEP, which is this.
Right.
And then this DEP is in terms of D underscore N.
Wait, why?
Because this softmax is taking, I shouldn't be just blindly pointing. So this softmax is taking in this as its variable. This is still constant. So it's going to be, so down here, this is going to be, yeah, okay. Where is this? So this ends up being DEP in terms of DP because we care about the softmax of this P value. And then, because P is our variable right there, right? Okay. Whew. A lot of talking. Okay, so then it's DP, and now this DP is going to be in terms of this D underscore N.
Okay.
That makes sense, right?
Yeah.
And then this D underscore N is just going to be the same as this DW3.
Okay. Some of the values you probably know, especially the last one. We already know that's H1.
Right. And then so this target, it's going to be the same, except this time with P's. So it's going to be the negative target P over P.
Okay.
And then we're multiplying that by this DP D underscore N, which, like I was talking about earlier,
yeah,
is where we're coming into problems. It's not going to be the same
right.
N1. So this is where we can, instead of thinking this as D to the N and D to the N, or sorry, E to the N over E to the N plus E to the P, let's kind of rethink this as E to the X over E to the X plus E to the C.
Okay.
And then when
but
we come
this one, are you doing the D over DN or D over DP?
Right now, we're going back to this DN over DN.
Okay, that's the okay.
And when we think about that, that's when this will become X. This will become X. This will become C. So down here, we're just going to consider this X and this X. And then we're going to do this again, but we're going to flip the script, and we're going to do e to the c over e to the x plus e to the c.
Okay.
Go back to this pretty blue. So we're going to do e to the c over e to the x plus e to the c. And again, it's this fun sum. Luckily, this time the derivative is much simpler because we have a constant in the top. We don't have to
right.
do the whole quotient rule thing.
We only have one.
Right, so this is kind of like 1 over x. So do you know what the derivative of 1 over x is?
No, I forgot that one.
It is 1 over x squared, negative 1 over x squared.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, x to the negative 1. Yeah, right. That one was actually the original rule, n x to the n is x to the power n derivative is n minus 1. Wait, hold on, n x to the power n minus 1. Got it. But because the power of 1 over x is x to the power negative 1, negative 1 comes on top. Got it, yeah.
And then dx. So let's write that. So we have negative 1 over x squared. So that's this. Sum of e to the x plus e to the c squared.
And the derivative of that.
The, yeah. Which is?
Just e to the x. Right?
Yep.
Okay. Let
me double check my notes. Oh, and we need to keep e to the c.
Yeah.
So then we end up, we can split this to be negative e to the c, e to the x, and
e to the x plus c, and e to the c.
E to the x plus c, oops, e to the c. And again, the sum, e to the x plus e to the c. What does this look like?
We have one of them is n and other is p. So this is p, this is n, and with
right.
negative.
But we can, yeah. So let's just say n and p, but it could be either. And then so now we have kind of like this sort of weird sort of rule. So if the, if both of them are the same,
mm-hmm.
then it's going to be
n times,
one minus n. But if it was like p over p, then it would be p times one minus p. And then this will always, anytime they're different, it'll always be negative np.
Okay.
So let me write that right there. So times negative np, and then again,
h1.
Right. Boom. Got our first weight.
Okay.
Now is where things get even trickier.
Ah, boy.
Oh, boy. Trickier than this? You're
yeah,
killing me.
This is... Well, Ooh. You are killing me. I'm just...
Maybe we should break this into, like, seven parts.
and the last part will be two movies.
All right, so now...
Harry Potter reference.
now we need... Let's do W1. We're not going to do all the weights because
Oh,
that's,
God, thank you.
That's a little
Okay,
extra.
We're going to do W1? Okay.
Right, and that'll be the last one we do. And that'll
okay.
show us some code.
Okay.
So we can have a little bit of closure and happiness.
We're
so,
already closing an hour.
Today. I know. It's a long one, but this is the finale of
Okay.
No more AI after today.
No more mad behind AI. It's just
yes.
gonna be like
Well maybe we'll bring some math back later.
Well if the audience demands it, we'll figure it out.
We'll force it on them. Alright, so where was I? Okay, we need to do So here's our cost function again. So we need to find the derivative of this in terms of W1.
Okay.
And again, we're going to split it into two because we got this nice little plus in here. So I'm just going to completely new page. DEN in terms of DW1, we're starting here. So, D, E, N, what do we need in terms of N, right?
Right.
Which we've seen this before, easy peasy. So, D, N, then we multiply that by?
D, N, then we figure out D, N.
And then what is it in terms of, where is D, N, D, N, D, N, D, N? Here, the softmax.
Mm-hmm.
So, probably dn, right? Because
yeah.
So this goes through here. So we care about dn. But then it also takes this fun path. So we need to do dn and dp.
Right.
How do we do that? How do we take a derivative with multiple
partial
variables?
Partial derivative, right?
Yeah. So we have a derivative rule for multivariate.
Right. Chain rule.
Actually,
no, hold on.
I never took multivariable calculus, so this is out of my wheelhouse.
Same
but
here.
Apparently, you can just add two of them together.
Well,
huh. well, I'll show you this. Okay. So instead of just doing one,
okay.
we're going to do dn, d initial n, and we're going to add that to the derivative of dn dp.
Okay.
So now we have these two chains that are going on here. So now we need dn in terms of. So I'm scrolling. All right, so you
can probably take it there too if you want.
That's okay. So we have dn, right?
Yeah.
And so w1 goes up. It doesn't go through anything else. So I think dndh1.
Okay.
Yeah. DH1
is directly in terms of DW1.
DH
underscore, yeah. Then that is, okay. And if you do that like twice.
Yeah. And then for those of you who aren't following this madness, if we go back to this equation, where were we? We were finding the derivative of dn, and we care about w1, so we just kind of go down the chain. The first thing is this ReLU that we need to find the derivative of, and then this h1, and then we can finally work our way down to w1. Okay. And then the same thing over here, except this time we're doing dp.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of?
DP is also in terms of H1. That one goes in, right?
Yep.
Okay. At least, probably the last two parts will be the same.
Yeah. So DH1 times DH1, D underscore H1 times.
Yeah, I'm just looking for
handwriting getting worse and worse.
I'm just looking for anything we can salvage from this.
All right, so we got this one side done.
Oh, boy.
Beautiful. I'm not going to do the other side.
Okay.
Do you think that's okay?
Yeah, no, I think people will forgive.
It's the same exact thing. You just follow the chain down. It'll be in the code, so you can take a glance at it there. But, yeah, just remember, we have this DEN, then we have the DEP in terms of DW1, and it's going to be the same exact. Most of the values are going to be exactly the same, except with the other values. That was very vague, but yes. Cool. So now, where's the highlighter? So we know what this is, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's just...
you calculated that before?
Right. Just this. Easy. We know this.
Yeah, that one.
That's just like the n
times 1 minus
n. Yeah. And then this.
Negative nt, yeah.
Beautiful. What about this?
This is
the derivative of this in terms of h1, which is
just
w3.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to write W3.
Okay.
And then, so that will also be W3.
Mm-hmm.
Just kidding.
Wait, what?
This one.
Oh, yeah.
It's W3. And then what about DP? DH1. That's going to be, since we're doing P and H1, it's going to be W4.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so check. W4.
Right.
All right, and then DH1.
That's going to be just one of the weights.
This is going to be the derivative of the ReLU.
Right.
So let's take a look at what this, oh man, I pulled a lot of papers out and we went through all of them. So.
Luckily we're not killing any trees to make these papers.
Right.
So
here's a nice little graph.
ReLU is the one like the zero then just becomes one.
Yeah, zero, then one. So let's just look at this derivative and see what it is.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think the derivative is? Let's draw it over here. So what's the derivative of this constant zero line?
So that's zero.
Boom. What about this? positive.
That's just one.
So this is the derivative
of
the relevant. So this is kind of a funky value. This is if this H1 value is negative, it's going to be 0. If it's positive, it's going to be 1.
So if H1 is like 0 and the derivative is 0, this whole thing becomes 0, which is nice.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
And then, so that's going to be the exact same as this. And then dh1 dw1 should just be our input. But let's go back to then. So yeah, dh1
it's just going to be
dw1.
X.
Yeah, x.
This one is from like previous. We have done similar things before. Yeah.
So this is going to be x. This is also going to be x. Boom. We have that derivative, we just add it to the other derivative. It's a giant chain of derivatives.
Okay. And you want to see some code?
Now, yeah, let's open up this code.
Oh boy, okay.
I hope that was fun.
Well, it was
burned
something. I'm not gonna like go as far to say it was fun, but it was not nothing.
It was more than
which one should I
go? We're going to part 4. Let's start with the Keras trainer.
Keras trainer. Okay, here we go. Let's quickly close this down. Here we go. All
right, so let's go through this.
Python extension. What? Okay, never mind. I think. Okay.
All right, so we've seen Keras code before. We can actually just delete that. Scroll up a little bit. We can delete this print weights class thing.
The whole thing?
Yeah.
Oh, this whole thing?
Yeah.
Like, I'll just comment it out for now.
Okay.
I don't know why my it's losing its mind.
Okay, so we're compiling this with, well, I guess scroll up to the top.
Oh, okay.
Right. So we have our standard model with, we're having two hidden layers. The input shape is 1. We're using bias, and if you scroll over more, we're using the ReLU activation.
Okay.
Our last layer, which is our output, 2 units, using bias, and its activation is softmax.
Perfect.
And then, again, we're using the categorical cross entropy.
That's the calculation we did there.
And then our learning rates is 0.1.
Mm-hmm.
And here, scroll up. These are our inputs, so -5, 3,
and the output,
7.
It, when it's -5, negative is 1, positive is 0.
Right.
That's what we wanted to happen. Okay.
Right. And then we're training it for 5,000 epochs. And then we're predicting.
Okay.
So go ahead and run that bad boy.
All right. So I will do, my terminal pops up. CD part 4. What? Oh, part 4. Python Keras. This one?
Yep.
What version of Python should it be running under?
3.
Oh, yeah. Hold on. Yeah, this one don't have. I have to activate my Python variables. Watch me not even have Python installed.
But yeah, so this is just.
Ooh, things are happening.
Cool, it's training for 5,000 epochs, and then we should have something loosely right. Okay, yeah, so. It got 1 wrong. And then 0.
Wait, we have, how many inputs did we have?
Here, if you scroll that down. We had all the inputs.
4.
So this should be, this was right. The second
but
one.
But why do we have 6 outputs?
Oh, that's the training. Scroll down. Scroll down more to the bottom. There, -8. So -8 was right.
Okay.
1, it actually got kind of wrong.
Well.
It's kind of close to 0.
Right.
If you run it again, it might be 100% right. So it just kind of, 1 and 0 is where it's kind of interesting. Sometimes 0 is 50-50. Tends to lean on 0 being negative. Then it got 9 and 10 right, and it got negative
0. Wow, 0 and 1 exactly. Okay.
There's our thing. It's working in theory. And then you can go ahead and open up the
Scratch trainer?
Yeah.
Okay, and I'll close this real quick. I'll close that real quick.
So it's using the same training data. Mm-hmm. We're initializing our model. And this is using scratch.py, which we'll go through in a second. This is like what I wrote by hand using no libraries.
Okay.
So we have our, we're initializing our model. I tried to keep it sort of similar to Keras. We're adding two hidden units, input shape of one. We're using ReLU activation, same softmax. Then we're compiling it. Compiling it fills the weights with random and zero, depending if they're weights or biases. Training it for 5,000 epochs, learning rate of 0.1. And then I'm just printing out the mm-hmm. results for each.
Okay, let's look at the actual scratch.py. What monstrosity we have here.
Yeah, so if you scroll all the way down the bottom, see how many lines of code it is. It's not too bad. It's like 200 lines of code.
Well, I mean, I see this. It doesn't fill me with joy.
Scroll up to the very top. Let's go line by line for this bad boy. So to start off, there's a couple things that
need and we only have mat and random, so yeah. That's cool. Okay.
So with our exponential function, we can end up overflowing because it's just way too big. And then sometimes we accidentally divide by zero. These things don't happen very often. To fix them, you normally have like an epsilon value when you add to the thing you're dividing it by, so it's never like actually zero.
Mm-hmm.
And then for exponential, then like you would just clip it down to like the max value if it's too big. And so this is just our softmax function. The top is just exponential of x, and the bottom we add the
sum of all of them.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then we're just dividing them. And then the ReLU you saw was just max zero x.
Yeah.
Which we went over before. So then when we add, we're just adding the unit's shape and activation to like this model structure array, just so we remember what the actual model looks like. And then we do this compile. And then so what this does, it loops through every layer in this model structure, and we call it next layer because the first layer in that is actually our second layer because we don't put like the input in that.
Right.
So scroll up. So this next layer, and then we get out this input shape, and that'll be replaced if it's not the first. So if I is more than zero, replacing this input shape with however many units is in that layer. And then here's the Glorot uniform, which we went over before. I added a link to the actual research paper where it talks about why they use this type of random initialization. And it's, long story short, it's because it makes it train faster. I guess back in the day when they're doing other types of random initializations, it was actually really hard to get it to learn anything.
Huh.
And then, so we're setting each node in the layer to a random weight, and we're setting the biases to zero.
Okay.
And this whole function is very dynamic. So if we do have more layers with more nodes, it'll function properly. And then so we have this fit function. This is where things start to not be as flexible. This will only work for ours because I'm hard coding all of these derivatives and we're looped through all the training examples. We calculate this feed forward, which if you want to scroll down to feed forward, we loop through each layer and we pass into that layer activated.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just the output of the previous layer, pretty much. And the first, if you scroll over the side, scroll up a little bit.
Nope.
The first is this XS, which is just X's. and we'll set that to activated. So it puts in the first, it'll calculate the layer. It'll give us back an intermediate and then activated. Intermediate is that like underscore H1, and then
right.
The activated is H1. And then it adds it to computed graph. And then you can scroll down to calculate layer.
Boy.
And then the first thing it does is it checks if it's a list or not a list. Because, for example, in ours, the first layer is only X. So that's not in a list. So if it's not a list, it just adds it to a list. So it's just a list of one.
Okay.
So, and then we find out however many units are in the next layer, and we fill that layer with values all zero, and we'll go through and kind of fill them through. So this is just kind of an unrolled loop of what this would look like. This isn't very efficient. This is just looping through everything and multiplying them together. Normally, you would use matrix multiplication.
Mm-hmm.
So remember, whenever our last time, our function was like way faster than Keras.
Right.
If we start adding more and more layers, more and more nodes,
yeah,
we're not actually doing matrix multiplication.
Right.
So it's going to end up being really, really slow.
So Keras will actually take over on bigger things. Okay.
Unless a way to fix this is we can start using NumPy and just
right,
do that and that. Like,
and
uses
then,
like, C-level code that,
yeah,
like, is way
and
more.
And then you have, like, the Keras again. So, like,
yeah,
just use Keras, people.
Yeah, so we're looping through each input, and we're multiplying each input by its weight. So each input has two weights associated with it, and that gets casually summed to the next layer. And then we do the same with the biases. And then we make a copy of that for our intermediate, and then we check what the activation of that layer would be. If it was ReLU, we pass each one through ReLU. If it's softmax, we pass the entire thing to softmax, because softmax needs all of the values.
Mm-hmm.
And then we return both of them.
Right.
And then if you scroll all the way back to the top again, whoop, and keep going down, 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 till we get to fit. Perfect. Go down a little bit more. So we calculated this feed forward, this computed graph. So that'll have, like, all of the inputs at each step and the output. And then we pass it through this calculate derivatives. We give it the inputs, our expected target, and the computed graph.
Mm-hmm.
And it gives us all of these derivatives. And then we add those derivatives to this accumulated sum for, like, that epoch. And then we subtract the weight by the learning rate times the sum of these derivatives over however many training samples there are.
Right.
And that's, like, our weight update step. And if you go down to the calculate derivatives all the way at the bottom right there, this is our giant mess of of a thing. We're getting the weights that we care about, the intermediates that we care about, and then these are just all the derivatives that we did by hand. And this is manually doing all that. So we would eventually need to rewrite this so this is more dynamic and works for just any shape.
Right.
But yeah, so this is the derivatives, gives us back, and then predict, it just runs it through the calculate feed forward, and then we're just taking the very last layer's values and returning it.
Okay, you want to give it a spin and try running it?
Let's do this, cross our fingers.
Okay, so I want to run
Python scratch trainer. _ trainer.
Okay. Well, it was faster than Keras still.
Yeah, but we only had
right.
A couple
hey,
of, yeah.
I'll take the smaller wins.
Yeah.
Okay, what is our input though? Let's look at the scratch trainer to look at the input so that it can match that our input.
So it's wrong, all the way at the bottom. So -8.
Ah,
so that's
go.
Good.
Okay.
1, got 1. Thought 0 was negative, which is understandable. Nobody knows what 0 is. Do you think 0 is negative or positive? Did you know that JavaScript, I think they have, like, -0, +0, and...
Again, there is, like, a whole video of JavaScript called What, W-A-T, and, like, it just talks about all the weird things JavaScript has. Anyway.
And then it got 9 right, it got 10 right, it got -3.
Like, there is one thing you can in JavaScript. If you're, like, you can, if you take an empty array, then try to get the truth value of that, you get false. But then you can take the false and treat that as an array and take the first index, and you'll end up with the character F. Right? So it's excellent. Anyway, so 0 is whatever. 9 was, well, one thing though, like, so when you're looking at positive and negative, like, your one is, like, I think kind of in the extreme, like, 1, 0 is just, like, cut and dry. Keras was, some of the cases was, like, 0.99 and, like, something like that.
Yeah, if you run it again, you might get that, too. It's just, it depends.
Okay. Yeah. Neuron just keeps thinking zero is negative.
It's pretty strong.
Yeah, like for example, if I run this few times here.
Yeah, see, at that time it was 99.
Yeah. Okay, that's fair. But we're already at hour 15.
Yeah, we're done. We finished. We trained our
right.
neural network.
So what is to come next?
Okay, so we started doing this sort of classification. That's
mm-hmm.
where we showed softmax and stuff like that, and we're using the categorical cross entropy.
Okay.
These are all things that we can reuse in image recognition. So next week, we're gonna build our own neural network. It's going to train Imato on MNIST.
Cool.
Or fashion MNIST. And you're like, yeah, what is MNIST? I actually don't know what it stands for.
Okay.
MNIST.
Is it something to do with image recognition?
Yeah, so it's a data set. It's a bunch of handwritten
okay.
digits. It's
okay.
like the hello world of computer
yeah,
vision.
I've seen that. I was doing the course from Coursera. If you haven't looked at it, Andrew Ng. He has a course in Coursera, amazing course. Definitely look into it. He actually talks about a lot of this math. So when I first did it, it was like, oh my god, so much math. But Nick kind of like went overboard with the thing. So you'll probably enjoy like that math a lot too. But he does the course in MATLAB, so I didn't like it as much and like the MATLAB part of it. But his course was excellent. But
his
next week,
definitely probably better than mine for sure.
Well, next week before we next week when we come back to AI, next week we're doing some Docker stuff. So I got inspired by your like doing it by hand.
Mm-hmm.
Next week you'll probably write a container from scratch.
Wow.
So we're gonna get a compute with Docker. So again, there's a couple of videos out there in the wild by Liz Reich. She works on I think Aqua Security, but she has like a couple of this video on YouTube. You can also find like writing something from scratch. So I got inspired by that. I got inspired by you to showcase something from like scratch. So I'll try to like demonstrate that as well, but we'll do it ourselves. We'll probably be able to see all the moving parts a little bit closer. So next week, hopefully we'll write a container from scratch.
Cool. And then so the week after that, I'll show you how to, I'll probably clean this code up a little
mm-hmm.
bit so that it can actually run on any amount of layers and shapes and sizes. And we'll do it on MNIST.
Okay.
Or fashion MNIST, which is a little bit more fun. It's like different clothing items. But the reason why we're doing MNIST is just because the images are really tiny. They're like 100 pixels or something by 100 pixels.
Okay.
So,
like
recognizing
hand digits. That
yeah.
Those, okay.
Yeah. So our model will be small enough that it can like actually handle that
okay.
without having to have like one of those big crazy ones yet.
But are you going to use something like Keras or are you going to handwrite the model too?
I'm going to try to update the Scratch trainer code so that it can actually
okay.
train on that. But we'll also do Keras.
Okay.
And then after that, we'll introduce convolutions and the reasoning why we use convolutions and stuff like that. So
okay.
we're getting there.
All right. So
thank you all for watching.
Yeah, thank you all for watching. Next week, interesting stuff are happening. You know, this video is going to get on YouTube hopefully soon. And again, if you, again, these are stuff I would probably go back and watch it a couple of times to make sense of some of these things. But
yeah, this was definitely a hard one. Don't get disheartened if this was like
right
over the
yeah.
Edge.
Just to clarify again, like this is not in day to day AI stuff because I have seen Nick some of his models he created and none of them has that much math in them.
No.
So yeah,
behind the scenes, yes. But I had this is the most math I've done in like years. So
yeah, thank you so much. See you next time.